We started with, to find some data available, for example, at GSPS or DRD or embassy or somewhere, which somehow gives us a comprehensive overview about the scientific exchange between Germany and Japan. But I, at least I, was not able to find data, or at least data that satisfied our approach, what we thought. And I'm very grateful for Professor Nagano. He had a presentation before. He gave me an internet link to a Japanese study from the Mirai Kogaku Kenkyusho. They do a survey focused on Japan, or Japanese, from a Japanese point of view, about movement and locations of scientists and students between Japan and the world. And Germany is a little part, and the biggest part, I have one or two slides later, of course, is our Asian countries and China in, especially. So now I try to start with that kind of attempt, and let's try to find it and to see the some of the ideas that I could recognize during that survey. So the everybody would agree that scientific exchange is a basis for knowledge and technology transfer. This expression is used in many talks, especially for from presidents at high-ranking levels, but at least to our feeling, it is not underlined by some data. Of course, if these high-ranking people are talking about huge atomic, or let's say particle colliders, and space projects, and huge projects with a huge budget, or also, for example, the fusion reactor in France in an international cooperation. But this is not a normal scientist working in Japan or in Germany from Japan. So these people are not, or their activities are not visible in a sense, or also represented. And as you see here, we try to find some evidence and at least some hints what these people are going to do, as also Professor Heisig said with her project with Charité. This is something very individual, but maybe not so much visible in the scientists' community. And that's the point, is how to say, to get some evidence-based or some measuring data on these kind of activities, which is also important, I think, for, as Professor Nagano said before, the advisory for the scientists, scientific advisory for the government, for the budget selective. If the people do not really know what they are spending the money for, they are reluctant to do it. Okay, so arguments for scientific exchange. Scientific relationship levels are different. There are cooperations between universities and institutes, experts, and also in the administration and governments, they have relationships together and exchange data, and also the big funding institutions, especially between Germany and Japan, GSPS, and DRD, and AFAHOF to some extent. And some nowadays we can observe individual groups, but at least to my impression, like Hexagon, that's an association of three universities, each in Germany and Japan, and the abbreviation is, I forgot, but that's the beginning of the university. I think H is for Heidelberg, and also some others. But they do not really publish very much about their activities and keep it very closed. And the one point we are coming from is the individual stays personally for one or two years in the other countries, Germans in Japan and Japanese people in Germany, and doing their research at this point, at this location, and these people are emerging not only in the scientific world, but also in the normal living, which is, I think, very important for both sides, also to see the normal life and the way of thinking and a lot of cultural differences. And as just noted, to get an impression of the other country outside the science is also, I think, very important. And also it gives an influence how much another country will be recognized, how much attention is paid from the political level. And at least from the German side, I think it is counted in one of the Japanese newspapers. I got this information from my wife, is that, for example, Angela Merkel spent only not more or only one day during her total chancellorship in Japan. So that's very little. And what are the benefits and the goals and motivations for scientific exchange? The task, the main aim is to find new scientific results and to produce papers and to get scientific advancement. And so the research stay on your own individual basis will bring a lot of new experience and like language and other experiences. So if we look a little bit about the scientific exchange structure in Japan and Germany, we can stick on this maybe 6 to 7 topics. Scientific exchange happens in different ways. So since 40 years, the individual exchange was almost the only, before that time, people came to Japan or Germany on their own or some special matter. But from that time on, 40 years ago, it became somehow organized. And the institutions like DRD and GSPS organized this kind of exchange programs for young or for researchers or mostly young researchers to go to the other country. So this kind of exchange is only, let's say, about 40 years old. So the scientific exchange between Japan and Germany, managed by DRD and GSPS, and to some extent AVH, or everybody of us knows quite very well. Both organizations operate the exchange with many countries. So Germany, if on the side of Japan, is not the only one. It's only a little part. And if we look in percent, for example, the most, let's say, very, very, very rough, we can divide the world in three sections: America, North America, Asian countries, and European countries, and each has almost 30%. And from these 30% in Europe, Germany is about 5 to 8% in budget and numbers and this. So these numbers, these are quite general. 25 years ago, the available budget for this exchange, which started very slowly, only a few people came to Japan from selected by GSPS. 25 years, this kind of program increased very much by the members. And the reason are the of course, the growing economy and the successful economies in both countries and the scientific boom increasing this kind of activities, international activities. The budget increased. That's a worldwide budget at the GSPS. DRD, I could not allocate it so easily. From about 1,000 million to 7,000, that's 1,000 million Japanese yen, that's about sevenfold in 10 to 15 years. And approximately 5 years ago, there came something additional, maybe a little bit longer. There was a new coordinated program started, that's so-called the project exchange. And this kind of exchange is going with defined goals. The projects between Germany and Japan are selected by a committee or by a selection committee, and both partners have to allocate their own money. So the German group and the Japanese group, each from their own government, the organizing funding organization like GSPS, they supply the management between the coordinating between Germany and Japan. That kind of money basically is even quite small. at that point, I would mention I have numbers maybe later. This kind of activities increased in during the years, and so both organizations, GSPS, have a quite big management facility to do this kind of work. The number of fellows in these projects also grew in that sense. So the point is about the expenditures on research activities. I was not able to find data on the scientific exchange only between these two countries. So I had a look at least to the German BMBF science and technology budget in Germany, which gives the world numbers. So these numbers are not based on Germany and Japan, because the reason was I was not able to find it specified on this on our topic, but it gives an idea about the importance of science in our society today and also for industry and economy. So I show a few numbers of the total national budget in Germany. We can see some numbers of the international comparison. We find the impact of science and technology money from abroad. That's one point which was not really much attention before, that each country has quite a huge input of science and research money from abroad. And this is also some kind of scientific exchange. So science and scientific results not generated in their own country. And two other points. So the first slide shows the science and technology expenditure in Germany. It grew very much since 10 years from something like 50 billion to 100 billion euro, which is about an increase from 2 to 3%. And there is here mentioned the part from the national gross products, GDP. So that shows a comparison between different countries. The right side is Japan and Germany. From percentage point, are very similar. There are differences. For example, China has quite a big number, but the percentage is still low. And in the European comparison, Germany is in the, let's say, in the upper level, like Japan in Asian countries. That is the slide of the expenditure. So I just want to focus on the part of foreign countries, Ausland. So the foreign contribution to scientific research is 100 billion euros. That's about 4%. That's quite a big number from foreign countries. And the total number is about 5. The top number was just the number from the industry. And here is a few, which shows the scientific budget contribution from industry, which is the dark blue, and from the government. So the industry and economy supplies about 2/3 of the scientific money budget in Germany. This is about here, it's about 70%. In Japan, even contribution from industry is even more. And this, I do not show these numbers because I want to discuss these numbers. The point is, if we look to the scientific exchange, also the industry has a big need of highly qualified scientists and good scientific results, which are also a basis for scientific success. And there is one slide which shows this indirectly. Here is the content of the export, the national export, based on scientific related products or products which need a high scientific input. So that shows in Germany is quite high, about above 10%. The Japanese numbers, at least in this slide, is a little bit low, but I do not want to discuss this in detail, because I just wanted to show science has a huge contribution to the economy. So it's at least in the 10% range of one country. So science is important. And that's one of the last slides from this series. It shows the scientific personnel, for example, in comparison with Germany and Japan. And that shows about from 100 employees, 1,000 employees in Germany, there are about 15, and in Germany, similar numbers are employed in the scientific field. So that point was to show the impact, at least of science, to the economy. And now I would like to come back to the scientific exchange. What I found out, as I said in the beginning, it was very difficult to find individual numbers showing this kind of scientific exchange between both countries. And even I think that's the same case for the other countries. The fellowship program, which one is one of the first ones, like postdoc and scientist, developed by the funding organization DRD, are almost the beginning. Then the cooperative project programs between both research organizations started, and also between single universities, as we had before, for example, Charité and Juntento University, or the big scientific institutions like Max Planck Gesellschaft and Fraunhofer Society. Then we have the networks within the research area. This is a cooperation between scientists, not moving to the other country, but doing common projects like joint projects, discussions, and mostly remote. They are active, and basically from the budget side, they do not need extra money to run these kind of networks. Then there is some kind, as I mentioned, of scientific exchange between the corporations. So those cooperations or exchange is mostly invisible because it's inside company organizations, or they are not so much going into the public there, but they are also occasionally involved universities and institutes and suppliers. And then there is research exchange between the large research organizations, as I mentioned also, for example, the German Aerospace Research Agency, the Japanese JAXA, and also nowadays, even starting and on the energy, big research projects based on both countries related to energy, or others like large scale projects from the particles and for example, also in the astronomy fields. But these kind of research projects are more visible because they have their own marketing and public relation offices to show what they are doing. But as I said, not as in the basic science. The situation, the scientific exchange as a criteria or as a function is not visible in statistical data. And for this reason, they are not so easily visible, and their importance cannot be realized for many people if they are not involved in that activity. For example, our alumni in the GSPS club, they know it because they have the experience, but it's sometimes very difficult to explain to outside. In comparison with the power of this kind of work, it should be realized a little bit more. The scientific exchange takes only a small part of the funding budget, but it contributes, I think, much more. So the goal should be to achieve better objective measurement data. Which one? I do not know in a moment. We should discuss this. And that's on the question. And the researchers and networking, for example, German people here in Japan, that should be also somehow improved. The German Center for Science and Innovation, the German Wissenschaftshaus, they are just starting to do some kind of events, so the researchers can do more exchange on their basis. So what data do we have on, or what data I found, I have to say, for the scientific exchange between Japan and Germany? The data, at least to my look at the internet, was very inhomogeneous. So I was not able to contact the big research organization directly because I'm not a member in that sense. So I had to rely just on the internet. For fellows, we have some statistical data over several years, and that data are from the Mirai Kogaku. So I was very lucky to find this kind of study to draw some data and some information. We have some data on the GSBS budget for the fellows, so the people moving from outside, from foreign countries to Japan. That's about 3,300 million yen for all over the world. So the budget for the cooperative projects are in a similar range, but the information is very little. Here I just copied, and if one is more interested, you can have a look at the internet. You find only the title, the partner's name, and yeah, that's I think almost all. And for example, the bilateral projects, joint projects, the budget is about 1 to 3 million year every year. There are other projects, for example, from Germany, it's the graduate exchange externship, graduierten Programme. There are two programs running between the Bayreuth and Tohoku University and the other one between Nuremberg and Nagoya. Networks within research area, that data are more, as I said, for direct researchers in both countries and companies. And here, in this slide, we see the number in the GSPS budget for scientific international scientific programs. That's about 5.7 billion yen. By available information about science exchange, we have a few numbers about the total number of people moving from Germany to Japan on doing science and also back. But this number is very, very much, let's say, not so consistent, but it depends very much from the source where the data come. And some good data or data, at least I was lucky to see, was the brochure for a 30-year GSBS fellowship program. They give some numbers and some ideas about the exchange of persons from international to Japan, and the brochure about international collaborations from GSBS. Not available are data about what more information about the fellows, what the fellows, for example, do afterwards their fellowship. Do they go to the industry or have they a more scientific career, and so on. And I think that's a slide which should not be here. On this slide, we see these numbers from the Mirai Kogaku Kenkyusho. So fellowship from going to Japan and out of Japan, internationally, not only Germany. So we see here on the left side, the Japanese people going abroad for short and middle term projects. So that's 1 month or a few months. And for longer term, that's more than 6 months or 1 year abroad. So there's a big difference between the long term and the short term. So that's, and that idea was before we could see that DRD and GSPS are going to rely even more beside of the personal exchange to the project exchange. So the project exchange needs only very short visits. So the main work of the research is done in the home country, and they meet for conferences and short meetings to finally adjust the data, and not the long-term exchange. The opposite way, it's the similar trend. The long-term exchange is much slower numbers than the short-term exchange, people going from foreign countries to Japan. And if you look to the countries, here we see that the researchers going, for example, to America are still very high. China is not so much. And the European countries are almost invisible. In the opposite way from the people coming to Japan, we see that China contributes the biggest part, and the other countries are almost not resolvable in that chart. And researchers going to Japan, that's, I think, the same slide. We should not go further on. That are some data from the DAD, but let me skip that. This slide gives an impression about the scientific exchange, which I mentioned in the beginning. There was a huge increase of the fellowship during the 90s from the budget, from the 1,000 million to 7,000 million, and also the numbers from a very few, maybe 50 worldwide, to more than 1,000 researchers or postdocs going to Japan every year. And what can we see as a possible development in scientific exchange? The trend, but we see that more projects and less individual fellows. We see that fellows are the basis for the projects, because these kind of projects, as Professor Heisig mentioned also before, if you start a project, the partners should know each other and trust. So most of the project heads doing this kind of research projects had an exchange program before that. And what we think is that the fellows doing a 1 or 2 year exchange in both countries are the real, let's say, that's maybe a little strange word, but they are the heroes and doing the groundwork for this kind of scientific exchange. That pattern may gradually change because of globalization and also internet and other ways of communications. And also we have to consider the employment situation for the young people in both countries. So do they have the time to spend 1 or 2 years of their career and also of their financial income in another country? So that we have to consider in the future. Maybe that has to change, and it will change also. And the point is, and maybe you could also recognize that the position to do this kind of internet research was quite, let's say, exhausting in that sense, because the data, at least the data we wanted to find, to show how important is the scientific exchange, was not so easily to find out, at least from my position. There might be more data available, for example, at DAAD or GSPS, but that may be a discussion if these data are more possible publicly available. There are two examples I found in the German scientific report from BMBF. There are a lot of projects from the Max Planck Society. For example, they have about 160 junior scientists and guest scientists from Japan, and about 150 projects with Japan. But they are not visible, at least from my point of position. And with Japan, there are three centers. One center is the Joint Center for System Chemical Biology. Another one is about time, Center for Time and Constants and Fundamental Symmetries, and another one for quantum materials. And also the Fraunhofer Society is doing quite a lot of activities with Japan. And with this kind of ideas, I would like to stop this little presentation, and thank you very much for your attention. Thank you.